Hi everyone, hope you all are doing good. Today I am back with another new topic from static timing analysis, that is timing arc and unateness. Previously we have discussed on the basic terminologies related to static timing analysis. If you haven't watched that video yet, you can click on this link here on the I button. Also I'll share this link on the description box. So without any further delay, let's get started. So first let us see what does timing arc means. Timing arc basically means the timing sense on the timing path from each input to the each output of the cell or a flow. Basically, it represents how much time does an input takes to reach to the output. These timing arcs can be further divided into two categories, cell arcs and the net arcs. So cell arcs means this arc is between an input and output pin of a cell. That is, the source pin is the input pin of a cell and sink pin is the output pin of the same cell. These cell arcs can be further divided into combinational arc and sequential arc. Combinational arcs means these arcs are between the input and output pin of a combinational cell. So as we know, combinational cell like AND or NAND, all the logical cells are combinational cells. And they will have two input, three inputs. So each input from rising to falling like that we'll check the combinational arc. Next is sequential arc. Sequential arcs are between the clock pin and either input or output pin. So if we take this example, so here we are seeing a D flip-flop, and if we see clock to Q representing the delay arc. So as we know, clock to Q we check for delay, and this clock to D pin is basically where we check for setup and hold time check we done. So that's why we call it as timing check arc. Next is net arcs. So net arcs are between the driver, that is the cell pin of a net, and load pin of a net. That is, the source pin will be the output pin of first cell and sink pin will be the input pin of another cell. So if we see this is a timing path where we have two cells. First one is the AND gate, next one is the OR gate. So if we see here, for AND gate we have two inputs and the output is going to the next, and there is a third input that is coming from outside. So here whatever is happening between this cell, that is represented as cell arc, and from the output of the first cell, that means whatever the source pin is, this is the source pin and this is the sink pin. So from the source to sink pin, whatever timing sense is happening, that represents the net arc. Also, we know that whatever cell information related to timing will be present only on library or the .lib file. And the net information or the net arcs, net delay that we get from the parasitic values, those are present on either SPAFE file or SDF file. So we know that timing arcs is having one unique property. That property is known as unateness. So basically, unateness means it basically represents that with whatever transition is happening on the input, with that how the output is getting affected. So that only represented by this unateness. So in simple language, you can say that each timing arc has a timing sense, as we already told, that how the output is getting changed for different types of transition on the input. This is called unateness, and it is very important for timing as it specifies how the output is going to respond for the particular input and how much time will it take. So timing arcs are of three types: positive unateness, negative unateness and non-unateness. First we'll see positive unateness. So in a positive unateness, if we are giving a rising transition on the input, we are supposed to get output to rise. And if we are giving falling transition on the input, we should get output to fall. That means there should not be any change in the transition of input and output. So whatever transition we are giving on the input, we should get the exact same transition on the output. So this is called as positive unateness. And its examples are like buffer and an OR gate. So if we see here, this is an example for buffer. So buffer is having two timing arcs. First, we have A as the input and Y as the output. So first, when it will be for rising edge, so when we are giving input as rising, we should get output as rising. When we are giving input as falling, we should get output as falling. That means there are two timing arcs that is coming for rising and falling. Next is AND. So for AND, if we see, there are two inputs. For buffer, we had one input. Now for two inputs, let us see. So AND is having four timing arcs. How four timing arcs? Let's see. So when we are giving input A for rising edge, let's say first we'll consider only for rising edge. When A will be rising, and so what will be the output? We are going to check. That is one condition. Second case, we are saying when B is rising, what will be the output for Y? Second, third, again for falling now. So when A is falling, what will be the output for B? When it is falling, what will be the output? So this four time, we are basically checking the timing sense. We are basically checking the timing arcs. So that's why AND is having four timing arcs. For rising edge, so if we see here, when A is equal to 0 or when B is equal to 0, and the other input, let's say when A is equal to 0, B is going from 0 to 1 because it is for rising edge. So when one input is 0, A is equal to 0 or B is equal to 0, the other input, although it is going from rising edge, means 0 to 1, that time we are seeing the output is constant. So whenever one input is 0 and the other input is going from 0 to 1, we are seeing output is also constant at 0 only. Whereas whenever A is equal to 1 or B is equal to 1 and the other input is still on the rising edge, that time we are seeing the output is still going from 0 to 1 only. That means it is changing its state. That means it is following the second input. That means whenever we are giving A is equal, let's say whenever A is equal to 1 and B is going for rising edge, that time Y is also going from rising edge only. So whenever input is, one input is low and the other input is for rising edge, that means 0 to 1, the output will be constant at 0 only. Whenever one input is at high, that means 1, that is the time, even if the other input is 0 to 1, that is in, it is going rising only, that means the output will also change its state from 0 to 1. Now let's check for the falling edge in the case of AND gate. So if we see here, so whenever one of the input is set as 0 and the other input is falling, that is 1 to 0, it is going from 1 to 0, that is the time we'll see the output as constant at 0 only. So if one input is 0 and the other input, although it is falling, it is at falling edge, but the output will be constant at 0 only. That means there will be no change. Whereas whenever one input is 1, like if let's say A is 1 or at least at B is 1. So if any of the input is 1 and the other input is falling, that is the time we will see the output is also falling from 1 to 0. That means first one, when one input is 0, it is depending on the first input. Means if the first input is 0, it is depending on that input and the output is coming same as first input. Whereas when one input is 1, means if second input or A or B, if any of them is 1, that is the time the second input, like whether it is at falling edge or rising edge, whatever the input will be there, same we will get the output. That is only positive unitedness. Next, let us see what is negative unitedness. So in case of negative unitedness, if we are giving the rising input, we are getting falling output, or if we are giving a falling edge at the input, we are getting rising edge at the output. That means we are getting just the inverted result or the opposite result. And its examples are inverter, NAND, NOR gate. So first let us see inverter. So as we told, for one input, we will have generally two timing arcs. So for inverter, let's say A is the input and Y is the output. So first we'll check for rising edge. So when we are giving rising edge at the input, we know for inverter it will invert the value. So we are getting falling at the output. When we are giving falling at the input, we are getting rising at the output. That's why we are having two timing arcs in inverter. Next, we are having NAND gate. Now we know two input NAND gates means, generally two input means we will get four timing arcs. That means each input will check, and each input will check for rising edge and falling edge. So for A, we'll check for rising edge and what will be the output. For B, we'll check at the rising edge. Again, for A, we'll check for falling edge. For B, we'll check for falling edge. Like that, four cases will be there. That's why four timing arcs will be there. Now first, let's see with this picture, let's try to analyze how for rising edge it's happening. So whenever we are giving one input, let's say A is equal to 0 or let's say B is equal to 0. If any of the input is 0 and the other input is going from 0 to 1, that means it is at the rising edge, that time the output will come just the opposite, just the inverted. That means if we are giving one input as 0, the output will come as 1. Okay, just the inverted value will come. Whereas if one of the input, if let's say A or B, if any of the input is having 1, that means it is already set high, and another input is going from 0 to 1, that is the time we are seeing again the reverse, that is it is coming from 1 to 0. So generally whenever we are having an input set at high, we should get the second input. Based on the second input, we should get the output. But here we are seeing if the second input is 0 to 1, we are generally seeing 1 to 0 is the output. That means we are getting the inverted value. Next, for falling edge, again if we see here, if we are giving, let's say A is equal to 0 and B is going 1 to 0. Now it is falling. B is going 1 to 0. Now we are seeing output will be 1 according to the truth table. Again, when any of the input is set as 1, that means it is set as high, and the other input is going from 1 to 0, that is it is falling, that is the time we are seeing just the opposite as output, that is it is going from 0 to 1. Next, we are seeing non-unitness. So non-unitness means the output transition cannot be determined not only by the direction of an input, but also it depends on the state of the other input. So its examples are like XOR, XNOR gate. So we know that for XOR gate and XNOR gate also we need minimum of 2 inputs. So for this one also we need 4 timing arcs. Now let's check for rising edge. So if we see the rising edge here, so whenever we are giving one input as 0, we as and the other input is going from 0 to 1. Okay, one input is set as 0 and the other input is going from 0 to 1. That is the time we are seeing the output is also going from 0 to 1. The output, whenever one input is 0, the output is going from 0 to 1. Means it is depending on the second input. So if one input is 0, it is depending on the second input. Okay. Second, if we are having A is equal to 1 or B is equal to 1, if any of the input is set to 1, means it is set to high, that is the time we are seeing output as 1 to 0. Whenever it is set to low, if any of the input is set to low, it is depending on the second input, whether it is 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, based on the second input, we are going to get the output. So if it is set as 0, we are whatever input is there at the second input, we are getting same output. But when it is set to 1, whatever second input is there, we are going to get opposite output for rising edge only. Next, let's see for falling edge. So whenever we are giving now, let's say A is equal to 0 and B is going from 1 to 0. Now it is for falling edge. So this is at the time what we should see. We should see output as like second input only. Like we gave second input as 1 to 0. So output should be also 1 to 0 only. So whenever we will give one input as 0, the second, based on the second output, whatever the second input will be there, output will also come as the same age only. Whereas whenever we are giving one of the input as 1, means whenever one of the input is set as high, the second output will be based on the reverse of the second input. Here the second input is 1 to 0, so the output will be 0 to 1. So when one input is, let's say A is equal to 1 and B is going from 1 to 0, that is the time output will be 0 to 1. Okay.
Thanks for watching this video. Do like and subscribe to this channel and don't forget to press the bell icon. Do comment down below your feedback on this video and share it as much as possible with your friends, colleagues and VLSI aspirants. See you next time. Till then, stay tuned and stay safe.